show her the Scarlet phone. You gotta see it.
This is the Scarlet phone.
She made me.
It's disgusting. Have you guys seen the Scarlet
phone? I can't believe it.
So gross. I can't believe you.
She's my favorite math teacher.
I was wondering about that. What did you do?
I taught you. John, the captain that I taught you. Football team, I say.
All for me.
You know Scarlett?
$50. She's a fat
one. Scarlett is so fat.
You want some?
James J. Friends, okay.
I don't know my products on, so. What's a product?
What's a product?
Hold on. Give me a good job.
I have watermelon.
Two for
your first question. What is your aspiration in life?
Oh, my aspiration in life would be to be happy.
Were you going to tell me? He's looking at me like I shot Martin Luther King or something. Like I've shot Bobby Kennedy. I'm telling you now. We're sitting in a park, enjoying one of the few days of sunshine. It's August. 1968, one of the worst summers on record. Besides, there's nothing to tell. He stares at a group of people our age smoking in the distance. A girl dances, moving her lips to a song we can't hear, and as if she has whispered some answer to him, we can live with my parents. And I laugh. I can't help it. And I remember why I love him. Well, do you have a better idea? When did we become so old? We're only 16, but I feel a century. And I wonder what the next century will look like. I start thinking about the year 2000, and what a strange number that seems. and I picture us in flying cars. And he's still talking. I catch the end of his diatribe when we don't have a choice. And just like that, I know that while I love him, we will not grow old together. We will not fly a car together into the next millennium, because like that, the freewheeling, laissez-faire, hippie eco-warrior I have fallen in love with has dropped his costume and become just another traditional boy. We have to accept the consequences. Last year, when we met at a rally, I fell in love with the way he'd have to fill silences. Could always talk. Now it's just annoying. Are you sure it's mine? I say nothing. It doesn't matter. I'll love it anyway. We'll live at my parents' and it doesn't matter. Finally, I speak. It doesn't matter because it doesn't exist. And he gives me this look. This ugly look. This look of disdain. Have you? Not yet. And he's relieved. His face loves me again. And he starts talking again. But my mind is somewhere else. My mind is in some sci-fi future, in the 2000s, where my daughter and I fly our car to the White House, where she is president. A lady president! When there is only love and not war. But even in this daydream, I know that my daughter is not the same one. Not this one inside me. He's still going on about his parents' loft when I say, I'm 16. Before I can say more, he's right in there as always. 16's practically an adult. My parents were 16 when they got married. We're capable of making mature decisions. And I agree, which is why I can make this one. It's my body. And the look is back. He looks at me like I'm a... But before he can say more, I'm up. I'm walking away from his voice in the car. And as I pass the other young people, the girl grabs my hand. She starts dancing with me. I don't hear any music. I'm fairly certain it's in her head, but I figure out the rhythm by copying her body. She leans in. For a second, I think she's going to kiss me. But instead, puts her mouth to my ear, whispers, us girls need to stick together.
Mirror.
My get ready soundtrack.
She sings about how last Friday night she went skinny dipping, then had a menage a trois.
She sings about how chains and whips excite me.
She sings about letting her see what you're hiding underneath, letting her see your peacock, and it puts me in the mood.
I shave my pits.
I wax my legs.
I pluck my brows.
I paint my nails.
I color my lips.
I rose my cheeks.
I darken my lashes.
I straighten my hair.
I lotion my stomach.
I sparkle my arms.
I dangle my ears.
I spray my neck.
I shave, wax, pluck, paint, color, rose, and darken, straighten, lotion, sparkle, dangle, spray.
Wax, pluck, paint, color, rose, darken, straighten, lotion, sparkle, dangle, spray. Wax, pluck, paint, color, rose, darken, straighten, lotion, sparkle, dangle, spray.
Ugh. And take a photo. Flash. Flash.
I hate the way I look.
I hate how small my lips are.
I hate the little hairs above my lip.
I hate the veins on my neck.
I hate my stomach blubber.
I hate my chunky ass.
I hate my tiny breasts.
I hate my wide hips.
I hate my wrinkly knees.
I hate my stubby hands.
I hate my long feet.
I take another photo. And it's time to go.
Party is at Tyler's house. He greets us in short, a fur coat, and no shirt. It's a pimps and hoes party.
Brianna plays, and we love her. Even though I boycotted Brianna on account of her getting back together with Chris Brown, I make an exception.
But that just shows what a strong woman Brianna is. That she sticks by him despite what he did. That's just loyalty, you know?
And we have a good time.
I know this because people's Facebook statuses have been said having a very good time at Tyler's party.
I know this because people are posting photos saying that we're having a good time. So we must be.
I know this because even though one of the girls is crying in the corner with mascara running down her face, we're still dancing and drinking.
And I hear Tyler tell one of the guys she's a cock team.
Rude.
Tight. Cold.
Ice queen.
Lead them on.
Vamp.
Prick tease.
Which is true. If you're gonna dress like that and not, you know.
And if you get a guy excited and then don't, like he can have a problem. Like have to go to the hospital, right?
What a pitch.
And I want to say it's all bullshit. I want to say that it doesn't make any sense. Because she would be a prick tease if she didn't, but she would be a slut if she did. So what about the space in between? I want to be in the space in between. I want to say this, but Rihanna's swirling through my brain and alcohol through my veins, or maybe the other way around, and I just can't get the words to come out. And somehow, deep down, I already know the answer. In between doesn't exist. So I just dance and take a photo.
It is 2 a.m. and I could totally kill a Big Mac right now. Like a real one, not Russell's.
Good.
She's trying really hard so that we won't notice. She's keeping her head down to be invisible, but through the vodka eyes focus on dipping fries into barbecue sauce, there's a good chance that we won't notice her.
Until someone, I don't think it's me, someone says, look, and the skulk of foxes raise their ketchup-blushed faces in unison.
It's been a good 2 months since we've seen her. I almost don't recognize her.
She's had a haircut. She's dyed her hair. And except for the little scar above her eyebrow, you wouldn't even know.
And what she's doing out of McDonald's in the middle of the night with some guy, I can't say.
Some guy from her new school.
And even when we were little, we understood the rules always still applied, even out of school. Unless you ran into someone with their mom, and then it was smiles and a wave or small talk while your stupid mothers chatted with each other. But otherwise, the rules still apply, which is why...
Scarlett!
Someone says it quietly. She doesn't hear or pretends not to.
Scarlett!
She still focuses her eyes hard on the guy, not blinking. Like, maybe if she focuses hard enough, we'll just disappear. Or maybe she will.
Scarlett.
You know the penis game we used to play in 9th grade? Like, someone will start off quiet, then get a bit louder, then louder.
Scarlett!
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 So even the 50-year-old Ronald McDonald behind the counter is looking over at us. And even more importantly, the boy with Scarlett is looking over at us. And we're all just barking.
Scarlett! Scarlett! Scarlett!
And it's funny, because I can remember the last time that I played a game.
And then someone goes over. Not me. I would never. I just watch.
Scarlett, how are you? Scarlett, don't you recognize me? Scarlett and I grew up together.
Scarlett still just stares ahead like she's scared or something. Like she's missed us up with the girl who came after school that day. Like in Scarlett's mind, we're all the same person? Scarlett, hello. Anyone in there?
And I don't understand why she doesn't say something.
Speak up! It's 2017. Women have earned the right to speak. She just keeps staring at the boy like she's a statue, still not blinking.
And I think maybe she died. You hear about it.
But then some water starts to come out of her eyes, so I know she's alive.
Scarlett is an amazing photographer.
Has she shown you any?
But the girl can't find it on her phone. And Scarlett's eyes finally blink. A hint of relief, a different ending.
But then someone, I or whoever it is, says, "I've got it," and finds the boy's phone on her Bluetooth and presses send.
Buzz, click.
And then we go home, or else it'll be another 30 minutes for the next night bus.
Heard from her. She doesn't go to the school anymore.
He's aware, but thought maybe some of us were still in touch. She was a St. Helens girl, after all.
After all, St. Helens girls are friends for life.
He thinks she may try to kill herself, or have already done so. He doesn't say this in so many words.
He doesn't say this at all.
But we know, we are intelligent girls.
He also doesn't tell us that on the Monday after we saw her at McDonald's, everyone at her new school had seen the photo. But we know this too. We have Instagram.
She's left a note.
We can't remember how we know this.
There's a girl in Canada who made a video before she killed herself.
Wait, is Canada in America?
And it's one of the first times a suicide is widely reported. Normally they don't, because they don't want it influencing impressionable young people.
In case we get ideas.
I mean, how dumb is that? We're not so stupid that we're going to kill ourselves just because some girl in the news did.
This girl in Canada made this whole video. You can YouTube it. With cards and stuff, talking about her naked photo that was sent around.
And her tormentors.
It's pretty grim. I thought Canadians were supposed to be nice.
Well, I'm not so sure anymore.
At lunch, I decide to go for a walk.
I decide to go home.
I decide to eat by myself.
I can't explain it, but I just don't want to be near any of these girls.
At night, the news is showing her school photo.
And I'd wish they stopped showing it.
And the newsreaders keep asking, where did she go? Why did this happen? Who is responsible? When what they really should be asking is why she isn't smiling in the photo.
Why are her eyes in the school photo saying, help me?
And my mother says, don't you know that girl?
And my mother says, didn't that girl go to St. Helens?
My mother says, wasn't that girl at your birthday party once?
My mother says, wasn't that girl at our house once?
My mother says, didn't you have a sleepover with that girl one time?
My mother says, isn't that one of your friends?
Yes. Yes.
Personality.
We miss your jokes. If you're reading this, know that.
And some of us are on TV.
The man is interviewing us.
And we tell the camera.
Scarlett was our friend.
We miss her.
We miss her beautiful smile.
We miss her winning personality.
We miss her jokes.
If you're watching this, Scarlett.
And we cry. For real. I feel like I'm gonna throw up.
And I feel like I've been punched in the stomach.
I feel like I've been kicked in the face.
Because the screen switches to live footage at the river. It's dark and you can't really see anything, but the newsreader in the suit erases any doubt. They found a body.
I'm not a slut, I just love love. We fall in love, but that's not it. Just wanna get some, ain't that some shit? You'll be my little friend, you'll be my little friend, you'll be my little friend.
Olivia is singing Let's Get Physical. When she kicks, I kick. When she punches, I punch. And the afternooners are playing in my mind, which only makes me kick higher. My forehead sweat harder, and my heart pound faster. This is 1985, and soon girls will run the world. I just can't wait to tell the girls at school. I've only been working at Pierce, Richards, and Stanley's for a week. My mother is nervous. They don't normally take on girls as young as me, but I want to be a lawyer, so my mom's made a few calls and got me this after-school gig a couple hours a week. I'm what you call a runner at the law firm. And a runner is not even a euphemism. From 4 to 6 p.m.,
I'm running between floors, delivering mail, delivering coffee, delivering photocopies, delivering staples and paper clips and memos and faxes all from other floors. And luckily for me, Olivia's gotten me into shape because some of the girls are a bit... they just can't work as fast as me. Which is why I don't think they like me very much. I'm raising expectations, one of them has told me. We're supposed to stick together, but I can't help it if I'm doing my job well, can I? I even bought this new outfit for work. Work. How cool am I? Some of the other girls are like, hey, what are you doing after school? Oh, you know, going to work to my law firm. And the other girls tell me to stay out of Stanley's way. Stanley is his first and his last name, which is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Unless they're just saying that to play a trick on me. But I don't care. But today, I've got these papers I got to deliver to Mr. Stanley's secretary. Only she's on break. So I knock on his door, and the first thing he says to me is, that's a pretty outfit. See, it's important to dress for success. That's what my mom always tells me. I don't tell him this, obviously. I just say, thank you, sir. And here's where it gets really good. As I'm handing him his papers, he puts his hand on my waist. What an efficient young woman you are. You'll be put to good use here. I want to be a lawyer, sir. And his hand subtly slid further down my waist. Well, then this will certainly be a good experience for you then, he says. I thought so too. I tell him, but I'm not so sure anymore. See, you're supposed to be this amazing lawyer, but you seem not to know about any kind of employment law. He doesn't understand. See, this right here would be considered sexual harassment in the workplace. And you seem not to know that, either that you've assumed because I'm wearing a pretty skirt. That somehow means it's an invitation. Or I'm too young and naive to know otherwise. Either way, if you do not move your hand from my firmly toned ass right now, I will stream this whole office down. For Pierce or Richards to see the pants off of you, then I will call your wife. I'm glad you like my skirt. I'll be sure to wear it again. On my way out, I see a secretary is back. He pretends to be typing on a Commodore 64, but I can see she's smiling. When my mother picks me up, she asks me how work was. I tell her, fine. She doesn't ask anymore. I turn up the car radio, Hall & Oates are singing.
Oh, here she comes. Watch out, boy.
Ouija board.
because standing there is Scarlett.
I can see her.
I can see her too.
And it's like, by being together, the St. Helens girls, we have brought forth the spirit of Scarlett into the room.
I would like to say something.
It's almost like she's actually there, because she is actually there.
At about the same moment, her parents will confirm the body in the river is not that of their daughters. Later discoveries will show it is that of a 14-year-old Latvian prostitute, and an autopsy reveals she died with a boot to her skull.
I have something to say. At first, I'm frightened, and then I'm confused, and then I'm relieved, and then I'm angry. I feel like we've been duped.
We have been tricked.
We have shed tears. We have made tributes, lit candles, and for what?
I would like to do my presentation now.
And our teacher is so bewildered, all she can say is,
sure.
You have asked us to research the history of women in our family, which was not especially easy seeing as my mother is no sentimental. Photos are nothing. But through a combination of stuff found at my grandma's house and photos and newspaper clippings found at the library, where I have spent the last couple of days, FYI, I can tell you all the following. My mother is one of only five Fortune 500 chief executives. She did this, I imagine, by donning shoulder pads and body checking any man who got in her way. Her mother, my grandma, was a teacher, which doesn't tell me much about history, but when she was about my age in the 60s, she marched with other women to make abortion legal, which was like a big deal. And she wore her hair in braids sometimes, and she had lots of sex, and no one judged her for it. Except maybe her mother. Were she alive? Because she, my great-grandmother, died when British European Airways Flight 411 crashed on approach to Manchester from Amsterdam. This is ironic, seeing as from 1944 to 45, my great-grandmother worked as a pilot during the war, delivering planes that needed to be fixed. Which is that exciting job to have? She wasn't dropping bombs or anything, but it was a big deal, because she was doing a man's job. And men were bastards, and didn't like women like my great-grandma doing a man's job. And her mom, she was a long time ago, so I didn't find much. But her name's mentioned in a Daily Mail article written in 1928 because she attended a scandalous pool party. I'm not so sure why it was so scandalous, but the man who wrote it from the Daily Mail did not like girls dancing to Negro music while drinking in bathing suits. Which show that some things don't change, since the Daily Mail still does not like girls drinking and having fun. But it does like taking photos of girls in bathing suits, so maybe things do change. I have basically learned in my family history, there were always men who made things shit for the women in my family. Things have moved on for my generation. Because it is not so much that the men are assholes, they are! It is more that the women are the assholes the men used to be. I used to ask myself every night, why? Why? What did I ever do to you? And then I would imagine 25 years from now, coming to my school reunion in my Armani suit with my beautiful husband and my beautiful handbag and my beautiful children. And when you all said, Scarlett, Scarlett, I'd say, I'm sorry. I don't recognize you. I don't recognize any of you. And then I'd leave. But as I sat on that packed bus, no one pointed. No one whispered. And I realized you are all
nothing.
There is a great big world out there where St. Helens means nothing. There is a great big world out there that is just ready to swallow you up, and when it swallows up you lot, it will vomit you back up. Because you are indigestible girls. That's the kind of girls you are. You are food poisoning. And the world will know you are girls like that. And you will be all alone. Together, but alone. Do you see? And I will forget you. I have forgotten you. Because I am not a St. Helens girl. But you will not forget me. After all, you have a photo to remember me by.
I delete.
she was like the mother hen, the one in charge. But the fox obviously didn't give a shit about the pecking order. Which kind of defeats the purpose, doesn't it?
Something has changed. I'm looking at the signatures on my t-shirt, figuring out who still needs to sign it. And it's like, I recognize the names, but I don't know them. Does that make any sense? When did everything change? I tried to rewind to find out the moment when everything changed, but I can't. I can't remember when I decided I no longer want to hang around girls like that. The video has been deleted, violated the user agreement or something. It doesn't exist.
And I want to take a photo.
A group photo.
Yes, one final photo of all of us together.
Gather around.
But we're suddenly temporarily distracted by a group of boys who go running across the field in their tidy whities.
There's no logic to why they do this, to why a group of boys are running, jumping, screaming, and laughing in their underwear.
Us girls sign school shirts. The boys run around half naked. It's in our DNA somewhere.
And it confirms for me what our teachers left out in history lessons, that while us girls have gotten more intelligent over generations, boys have become more stupid.
And I'm a bit jealous. I want to run around in my underwear instead of stand here with a Sharpie in my hand. And I think about doing it. Just doing it. Run, strip off, and join the boys.
But they're too far. They're gone. And I've missed my chance. A photo! Gather around!
The St. Helens girls.
My mother told me these girls are my friends for life.
One final photo to use for the Facebook page.
A photo with smiles, and her arm around her waist.
And her arm around her waist.
And her arm around her waist.
And her?
But someone is not here today with stomach cramps.
And someone is walking away to the bathrooms.
And someone says, this is a stupid idea.
And someone says she doesn't want to be in the photo. She'll take it.
Which defeats the purpose, because it has to be all of us.
And another girl says, well, it's not gonna be all of us, and I don't know what she means by this.
Like, what does she mean by that? Like it's my fault somehow? What does she mean by that?
Like, would it kill her to be in a photo? And those of us who are standing there with our arms around someone's waist just start looking kind of dumb, because no one's taking the photo.
So she takes her arm off her waist.
And she takes her arm off her waist.
And she...
And the moment is gone, and there will not be a photo. Which is actually really frustrating. We will look back on this moment, and we won't remember it. Because there will not be a photo. Which is a wasted opportunity, really.
And I don't get why some of the other girls have to ruin it for the rest of us.
Why can't they just go along?
Be a team player.
There's always a couple who have to stand apart from the crowd to feel individualized, which is pretty pathetic if you ask me. Girls like that ruin it for everyone.
Bitches! Sluts!
And so I just start snapping photos.
Flash!
Flash! Flash!
Flash!
Crack!
Smash!
It falls.
It breaks.
Which is called pathetic fallacy here. Foreshadowing. Something. I don't know. All I know is it will never be all the girls together again.
I am with all the girls together again.
We're in the reception hall.
16 5-year-olds singing Sleigh Bells Ring. Are you listening?
We are 45 years old. They are rebuilding St. Helens, a brand new, state-of-the-art, all the bells and whistles, blah, blah, blah.
All the St. Helens girls were invited to a reunion of sorts.
There's 200 in all. Everyone from our year has made an appearance. And it's nice to see the old faces, because over the years, despite our best intentions, well, life gets in the way, doesn't it?
and I'm not sure why I've come.
I can't believe I've come.
Maybe out of curiosity?
Maybe out of some weird, twisted obligation.
Maybe I think I'm gonna give her all the unsent emails I've written over the years.
Maybe to see her entrance, like she promised.
Then, after the current reception class finishes singing, we have some time to catch up, to reminisce about the school shows when I was the lead.
And that boy we used to like, Roger?
Can't remember. But one of the girls ran into him, and apparently he's fat, bald, and works in IT.
And someone still sees Tyler. We used to have all the parties. Who has a much younger boyfriend, who's also a model.
Go figure.
And it's like no time has passed at all. It's like we're 16 again. Except I have a 16-year-old.
My daughter's 10.
Mine are 6 and 8.
Mine are 12 and 13. God help me! Can I fast forward, please?
My three are all boys. I still don't know what to do with them.
I had my tooth tied. My girls are at the age where I say, "How was school?" And all I get is, "Fine." I've stopped trying to get more out of them. Futile.
And I look around for her, but she's not there. I don't think so, anyway.
On our way to the parking lot, we see the reception girls in the playground. But something's wrong.
One of them's building a snowman, but someone is trying to ruin it. A boy.
And I wonder if I should intervene. Should say something. Well, what would I say? So we just watch.
Then, without a word, without planning, the girls start filling arms. All 16 of them?
Making a barrier between the boy and the snowman.
Her arm and her arm.
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 And one of them speaks, the smallest of the group.
Us girls stick together. Think you can break through us, boy? Go on. Just you try.